Hilltop. Welcome to today's Alumni Career Services webinar sponsored by the Georgetown University Alumni Association. We're so glad to have you on the line. Thanks for taking time out of your day to join us for converting pre-planned events into remote experiences, a fireside chat with Jesse Colligan, SFS Class of 2014, and Tony Lew, Managing Director of Insurtech New York. This webinar is co-sponsored by the Georgetown Tech Alliance of New York. I'm Sarah Smith, Senior Associate Director of Alumni Career Services, and I'll be facilitating today's webinar. Before we get started, I'd like to share just a few webinar tips and housekeeping reminders. This webinar broadcast is being recorded, and the recording of this webinar will be made available on our Alumni Career Services YouTube channel within 48 hours of today's broadcast. You'll receive the link to the webinar recording in a webinar follow-up email, which will also contain a post-webinar survey for you to take, information on upcoming webinars, and more ways to stay connected to the Hilltop. Jesse and Tony will answer questions at the end of their webinar, so please send in questions as you have them throughout the presentation using the questions area of the GoToWebinar system. And finally, if you're having any technical difficulties or other issues, please submit those concerns to me also via the questions area of the GoToWebinar system. Without further ado, I'm going to go ahead and turn things over to Jesse and Tony for our presentation today. So take it away, y'all.
Awesome. Welcome, everybody, to our webinar today. Really excited to have you all here and have Tony here as well. So just to kick things off, I'm going to quickly introduce myself. Tony can introduce himself. And then we're going to launch a few poll questions because we just want to get a better sense of where you're all at, why you came to this. So we can make sure that you get the most value out of this as possible. We'll customize exactly the content depending on your poll responses. So to start off, my name is Jesse Colligan, graduated from the SFS undergrad in 2014. I'm also founder of the Georgetown Tech Alliance here in New York City, where I'm based, and we're sponsoring the webinar today. Excited to have Tony along with us. So Tony, maybe you could quickly introduce yourself.
Hey, no, thanks for having me, Jesse, and the rest of the Georgetown alum. I'm not a Georgetown alum. I went to Carnegie Mellon, but I did live in Arlington, Virginia for 6 years and know a lot of Georgetown folks. So go Hoyas. I lead an organization called Insurtech NY. It's a community-based organization in New York to help accelerate the digital innovation of the insurance industry. We help connect startups, carriers, brokers, and solution providers and investors in this ecosystem. Happy to provide any kind of information that we have gained by running our virtual conference. And so thanks for having me again.
Awesome, cool. So to get started here, we want to start with our polls. So we have three questions we want to ask. Sarah, if you wouldn't mind launching the first one. Again, this is just to get a sense of who's here in the audience today. We have over 100 people, so just to get a sense of why you came to this. So the first question is, do you have a meeting or event coming up that you're involved in converting to remote? So I imagine the answer probably for many of you is yes, but it might not be. So we just want to start off with this.
I'm just gonna leave this open for a couple more seconds. Y'all just take a minute to respond to the poll that's up on your screen right now. Thanks for your participation. It's good to hear from you guys. So I'm gonna go ahead and close this. Let's see, it looks like 73% of the audience said yes, 3% said no, and 24% are in the probably but not right now camp.
Awesome.
Yeah. So your okay, hypothesis great. Is correct, Jesse.
I'm a wizard. Yeah. Excellent. Can we launch the second poll then, please, Sarah? So this is a little bit more about your events coming up. So if you are planning an event in the near future, how many people roughly is it for? I think the challenge here, of course, is it's going to be very different if you have a 10-person meeting or event versus a conference for 1,000 people that you're trying to pivot to be mostly online or entirely online. So this is just to get a sense of where people are at in terms of the size of the meeting or event that you're having. And just as a quick reminder, Tony, I think you may have mentioned this at the beginning, but your conference was for, I think, 500 people, a little bit over 500, is that correct?
Yes, about 500 people.
Cool.
Those are the number of people who registered, yes.
Awesome.
So looking at the results of this poll, less than 10 in terms of size is 10% of the audience. 23% have events that are from 10 to 50 people. 19% have events that are from 50 to 100. 33% 10 to 500 people, and then 14% more than 500 people.
Got it. Wow. Okay, cool. So it's pretty evenly distributed, but it looks like there are a lot of people with, you know, more than 100 people at their event. So that's obviously a pretty significant challenge. Sure. Cool. And then the last question that we have, Tony could talk a lot about his experience in different dimensions and different categories of things, but we wanted to hear specifically from you what you're most interested in hearing about. Is it about technology considerations? Should you use Zoom, GoToWebinar, or something else? How do you do virtual networking, team and staffing? How do you staff a virtual event, hold them accountable, et cetera? Event design, how do you design a virtual event? Of course, again, this is very different than doing an in-person conference design. Speakers and content, and virtual networking. So what are you most interested in hearing about? And I believe this is a single choice only. So choose your top choice.
I'll just leave this open for a little while longer. Let a couple more of y'all respond. We're getting great responses on these polls, so thank you.
Awesome.
Let's see. It looks like our three biggest buckets are event design, with 38% of the audience saying that's the one they're most interested in hearing about, followed by technology considerations. 25% of folks picked that one, followed by 22% for effective virtual networking. And then down from there, 9% of the folks said team and staffing, and then 5% said speakers and content.
Awesome. Cool. Thank you, everybody, for answering those polls. That's really helpful to help us hone in on exactly what you want to hear about. So, Tony, let's kick it off here. Let's have our little discussion. So you hosted a conference at the beginning of March, I think March 13th or something like that. What was the exact date? 19th.
March 19th.
Cool. And you had to pivot that from 100% in person here in New York City, right, at some hotel or event space, I imagine, to be 100% virtual. So can you just talk us through what the conference was for first, and kind of how you were leading up to the planning, thinking that it was going to be in person, just to kind of set the stage before the decision to take it virtual?
Sure. So this was going to be our first big conference. So we've been running smaller events all in person over the past year. And there are about 100 people in person, evening form events with like 2-3 hours in length. So that's what we've been doing, and we're, you know, fairly successful running that. And so we wanted to go bigger and do a full day conference obviously all in person. And increase the number to 300 people. So that was our initial goal.
And so this was your first big conference.
It was our first big conference, right? And we actually got a little ambitious, and not only did we do panel discussions and networking, and also like we also have this thing called TED style talks. We added a two track startup competition as well, all in one day, packed in one day. And so what that meant was there are actually like 80 people who needed to participate as like in front of a stage, right? Or interacting in some way. It included startup founders who are pitching. There's 20 startup founders, obviously speakers and moderators and others, but there are also judges as well, who there are like 30 judges who are participating. So there's a lot of people who are participating. But everything was going as we planned. Things were in motion. We got the space. I mean, everything was humming along. And we actually tried to be fairly aggressive in selling tickets and getting sponsorship earlier. So by March, we have pretty much sold all the tickets that we wanted to sell, and everything else would have been like additional bonus.
Wow. Awesome. Cool. So everything was going well, it seems, and maybe you were overachieving a little bit, going over your participant goal and maybe fundraising goals for this conference, partnerships, et cetera. And then COVID-19 hits, right? So yes. obviously things were developing very quickly in early mid-March. The NBA was canceled, then, you know, all these other things were canceled, just kind of pile. So when did you make the decision to actually pivot to virtual? And how did you have that discussion internally with your team? I'm sure you talked about canceling, refunding, what's the best thing to do? Yeah. You ended up with virtual. So talk us through that process.
Yeah, so we've been actually monitoring the COVID situation probably since January. I'm originally from Korea and my family's in Korea, so I've been talking to them and they've been kind of going through this a little earlier than us, right? And so I kind of knew it was there, but honestly, I'll be honest, I didn't take it seriously. It was like, hey, if you're like under the age of 70, then you know, you'll survive. It's like a cold. I didn't really know the difference between COVID and the flu. Right. And so I was basically like ignorant. That's what I was. But that's kind of, I think many of us were, at least in the US. But we're monitoring and really we're concerned not about like the health of the attendees or anything like that. We're kind of concerned about governments potentially shutting us down. So that's kind of what we were running up against. And we looked at Europe and other countries, none of them were shutting people off. And I think Swiss was the only country where they were limiting gathering of more than 500 people. So we are under the threshold of 500, right? So we're like, we're okay. And like, honestly, I really didn't think that we were a health hazard, because at least in February, even early March, there was like two people who had COVID in New York, right? So it wasn't,
right. It wasn't detected.
Yeah, and the NBA wasn't canceled, right? Everything was going normal. So we're monitoring, but we had it in the back of our minds, if for some reason we have to shut it down, they will convert to virtual. So it was in the back of our heads that we will not cancel. We could probably do everything we wanted to do virtually. We didn't actually plan on like how to convert it, but it was in the back of our heads. And then the other thing is, I also run another business called CoSolo, which is a virtual community for consultants. So I'm fairly familiar with how to run things virtually. I've never done anything where there's 300 people, but I've run Zoom and all kinds of stuff like that for like 20, 30, 40 people multiple times. And so I was familiar with the technology at least. So basically, when did we decide to switch? This was basically 1 week, exactly 7 days before the conference, March 19th.
Gosh. And
there was a big...
So just pause right there. Let's repeat that again. So yeah. 7 days before a 500-person conference, you made the decision with your team to pivot to 100% virtual. Right. Yeah. So that means within 7 days, you need to communicate all that out to all of your sponsors, the venue itself, which I'm sure that's a whole situation we don't need to talk about, but I'm sure that was complicated. Getting the speakers on board to do virtual, figure out what technology you're going to use. Like there's a lot to consider, right? Within 7 days.
No, that's, you're absolutely right. I mean, 7 days, retrospect, I don't know how we did it, but we said basically 8 days before. My partner, David, and I were talking and we're like, you know, I know we said we won't cancel and we'll run virtually, but there'll come a point where we can't even do virtual because we need some lag time to be able to do that, prepare, right? And he said, yeah, the minimum we need is probably like 4 or 5 days, right? But then that particular night that we had the discussion, there was a big announcement by Trump that there will be no travel from Europe, okay? And that's when all hell broke loose, because we had a lot of attendees coming from Europe, even speakers, and then we were like, okay, we can't do this in person. We gotta switch. And so that's when we decided to switch that particular day. And the rest is history.
Wow. Okay. That sounds intense. So can you talk us through what your mindset was with your team of pivoting to virtual? I'm sure you didn't have like a perfect game plan. As you mentioned, it was kind of in the back of your mind, but you didn't have like a concrete, okay, this is plan B, we're going to execute A, B, C, blah, 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 right? That just didn't exist. So was it chaotic? Did you have kind of a structured plan that you did and focused maybe on like the first day or half day to make sure it wasn't chaotic? Like how did you approach that? And can you talk about each of the considerations? I think in your article, you mentioned 5 key areas that you really focused on. So maybe touch on those.
Yeah, so I guess I can talk about the actual discussion we had when we made that decision, which is before we decided to switch, we talked for about an hour. Actually, this was in coffee shop in front of the event space that we were going to use. And we were actually going to tour that space that day when this happened, right?
Oh, so, my gosh. Wow.
And so we're discussing for like an hour, and we thought about what do we need to do to make this happen? And I think that the things that you just mentioned are basically what we discussed, which is like, hey, technology, what can we do? And we knew Zoom can handle it. Zoom webinar. I've never used Zoom webinar, but we have used Zoom conference. This is different. But I participated as an attendee Zoom webinar. We knew that could work. So we were like, okay, we're good with technology. We weren't sure about the networking app, but let's say we could figure that out. But I think the most important thing is we need the speakers and sponsors to continue to support us. And so we said, okay, let's call all of them, get yes from all of them that day, right? And if you get yeses from most of them, then we can communicate to the attendees about the switching. Mm-hmm. So that's what we did. So like that particular morning when we had that, it was a cafeteria in Little Italy. There's literally no one there because this is like next to Chinatown. We had a conversation. I said, hey, there's no reason for me to tour the place because we're not going to use it. So I'm going to go back to my office and start calling people. And then I started calling, and my partner started calling, and fortunately, like, basically everybody said yes. They're like, sure. And then they were actually relieved that we were doing this.
Were there any difficult conversations there at all, or challenges, or was everybody pretty much like, okay, that's actually exactly what I wanted. Perfect.
In terms of speakers and sponsors, they were like 100% said yes. There are a couple people who had backed out a week before, right? And then because they're out before, and then by the time we called in, their schedule was already booked, but like it wasn't because of the COVID situation or something else. So anyway, like everyone said yes, and they were actually happy that we're doing it. Yeah.
Got it. So step one, call all of your partners, your sponsors, your speakers, get them on board for this pivot to a virtual event before you communicate out anything else to the attendees.
Yeah, exactly. Because, I mean, they are the content, right? When you're running an event, speakers are your content. And so you want to make sure they're on board. Mm-hmm. And then, again, technology is also your product. So your technology decision is super important. You have to make sure that, you test out different tools that are out there and make sure you find the optimal tool that you're familiar with and can handle everything you want to do.
Can you talk about that a little bit further? Because I know technology considerations was one of the poll responses that was most popular. How should people approach that? There are many different options that exist. And of course, it depends on your budget and how many people you need. You know, if you want to do a webinar style, if you want to interact more, we were just having a discussion before the webinar kicked off with Sarah about virtual networking and different things that Georgetown's doing there. How do you do breakout? Like, there's a lot to consider. Do you have any sort of framework to think about that or key questions about your event to make sure that you're thinking through that in the best way?
Yeah, so at a high level, there's tools, and then there's also like general infrastructure. So in terms of tools, there is a web conference tool that you need to make a decision on. So I mentioned we use Zoom, but GoToWebinar is definitely another great option, which you're using right now for this conference. There's a tool called BlueJeans. There's also a WebEx tool. There's multiple tools out there, right? And they all work, and they are all not perfect. They all have issues. So you need to figure out what is most important to you and then try them out. Choose the best one. Make sure that it can handle the capacity that you're looking for. If you're looking for a 10,000 people conference, then some of these tools may not be the right fit for you. So definitely check them out and test them. Test them. So that's number one. And then number two is this is something you don't necessarily need to have. But if you're running a conference, a lot of times, or event, in-person event, a lot of the reason, one of the biggest reasons people come is to network, is to meet other people. If you do a virtual conference like this, you're not able to like have a, I'm not able to have a conversation after this speaking, you know, situation with attendees, right? It's just difficult because we're not together in person in the same space. But there are other, there's tools out there that allow you to make a connection virtually. So there's a networking app that that you can purchase as well, that will allow you to do one-on-one networking or other kind of virtual networking. So we actually were partnering with a company called Grip. And
Grip?
Yes, Grip, G-R-I-P.
Cool.
They're, I think they're a UK-based company, but we're actually planning on using them anyway because they have an in-person event meeting app. That's what they're known for. So we had already purchased and made a partnership deal with them. But we found, fortunately for us, we found they actually have a virtual option. So it actually worked out pretty seamlessly for us. So that was really helpful. But there are also other tools as well on the virtual networking app. So definitely test them out. Again, not all of them are perfect, but you know, so you just have to look at what's important for you. So there is that. There's also other tools like Grella and Hopping are some of the other options. So those are the two tools that you need to make sure you, you know, you do a great job just, you know, selecting.
So just to recap, the two tools that you're talking about, whatever, you know, specific brand or company that you're purchasing them from, is some sort of you know, webinar or Zoom-like or GoToWebinar virtual meeting platform. That's the first, obviously essential. And then the second one is, in addition to that, some kind of networking app. Is that fair to say?
Yeah, and I would say the networking app is somewhat optional. It just depends on what kind of a conference you want to kind of run. But it was necessary for us because we knew our audience, our attendees, many of them came for networking.
Right, sure. As for any event, I think that's true. Cool. I'd love to go deeper into that a little bit later, but wanna move on to the next topic that beyond technology, which I think is team and staffing, right, is what you've talked about in your article.
Yeah. So it's obviously very important. I mean, when you're running an event, there's a lot of people involved, but the roles that you need to have in a virtual conference versus in person is slightly different. So I just want to make sure that you know what those roles are. So first is, you know, you need to have an MC who is really engaging and can brighten up the room and, you know, just be a good communicator, right? And you need a dedicated person running that all day. It could be like Jesse running, maybe Jesse's for hire. You can do an MC all day, right? You just need somebody who's constantly in front of people transitioning and talking about different events in between the events and doing a lot of transitions. So that's very important.
Who is your MC?
We had a partner named Roy Hansraj, who is
I think I've actually met him.
Oh yeah, he actually does a similar thing as you, but for RPI. So
that's right.
For RPI, so he was super engaging, very charismatic, and just a fun guy. So we had him dedicated to that. You also need someone who would make sure that speakers are joining on time. This is probably the most important role that you need to have. Because as I mentioned, speakers are your content in a conference, right? So if, for example, for this conference is myself or Jesse didn't join, then it would be a disaster. So Stephanie and others made sure that we joined. They continuously sent us email. I'm sure that if I didn't join 10 minutes before, they would have called me, right? But you need a dedicated person managing that.
Maybe we could call this person your speaker shepherd or something.
Sure. Yeah, we call it speaker manager.
Speaker manager. That works.
Yeah, and for us, it was super important because we had basically 80 plus people participating in some shape or form as a speaker. So we needed to make sure they're like on the, you know, when they're speaking, that they're on it beforehand, so we can make sure they're prepared. So definitely need that. And we actually had two people manage that. You need a person making sure, like finding out, are they in or not? And then someone calling them. So you kind of need to. And then we also need someone who's managing the slide. So right now, there's no slides, right? It's just video, but a lot of the sessions, we actually have slides. So we need somebody who is actually managing the slides and making sure it just goes forward and backwards and whatnot. And then you also need somebody who's checking time. In an in-person setting, you probably also need someone who's checking time, but it's actually very important also in a virtual setting that there's a timekeeper, and make sure that timekeeper is dedicated to timekeeping and not also doing slide management and other stuff, which I was doing. And so I actually, was doing all of these, many of these roles on a part-time basis. And there are some times where I kind of didn't call out the right, the time's up. And so that's not ideal. So learn from my mistake, have a dedicated person who keeps time. And then finally, you need a help desk person. So this is a technology product, right? Web conference is a technology product. Things can go wrong. I think one thing I didn't mention in the technology section of our discussion is there's things that definitely could go wrong in terms of internet, speed, in terms of audio, people can't join, whatever. There's a lot of failure points in web conference. So you want to make sure there's at least one or two people who can actually manage those situations. And so we handed out like email addresses, phone numbers of someone they can call.
Mm-hmm. Got it. So just to recap here quickly from, I was taking notes as you were talking. You need your MC, of course, that's a critical role. Someone to manage the slides, someone to manage the speakers, just to make sure that they're showing up on time to all the, and go to the right breakout room or whatever.
Yeah.
A timekeeper and a help desk person or persons. And I suppose each of those roles could be multiple people as well.
Yeah, for each of them, they could be multiple. Yeah, you're right. Yeah. But you try not to have same person play multiple roles.
Yes, definitely. Yeah. That makes sense. Cool. So let's talk about event design. I think this was the most popular response in our poll of things that people wanted to hear about. So, I mean, when people think event design, they think flower, at least for me, like flowers, drapes, lighting, yeah. All of that is in-person stuff, yeah. Right? Theoretically.
Right.
As you can probably tell from my, my background here. but so how do you even approach thinking about that for a virtual event?
Right. So I basically, in terms of the design of the event, this is assuming you already pre-planned your in-person event, right? Obviously, you can replicate the flowers and the physical nature of things, but your speaking panel sessions, how you design that and the breaks, all of that is transferable in a virtual setting. So you only have to change in terms of like the overall design, but I'll add a few potential tips that you probably need to think about because it's virtual. So first thing is in an in-person event, you could have a lot of breaks. So for example, you have a panel discussion, right? And then you go on a break, right? And that's totally fine. And stage could be empty. And during those empty times, people are networking, chit-chatting, going to grab coffee. It doesn't feel dead. In a web conference, if your stage is empty and nobody's talking, it feels dead, right? Because you're not interacting with
people. Because people can't talk with each other or go get coffee. I suppose they could get coffee in their home or apartment or whatever, but
It feels almost like something's going wrong. Something's off here, right? So you don't want that to happen. So you don't want like dead space. So you want something continuously running throughout the day, even during breaks. And then the second thing is sort of related to this, but you want the event to be entertaining as much as possible. And the reason for this is you're in front of a computer and you're in your own space. You have many other options. When you're in person, you're just at an event and you have to be there. You don't need
you have your cell phone. I don't know if you've gone to events. People can tune out very easily. But your point's well taken.
Yeah, that is true. But like you can't walk around and do stuff, or you can go to another conference, right? If you're doing a web conference, there could be literally another conference you could go to. There's a lot more options, a lot easier to tune the event out. Because you're in a virtual setting, it's just really easy to be disengaged. And this is whether it's a conference or you're having a virtual meeting, you might have found yourself just tuning out. Even you're having two one-on-one person meeting, it's just easy to like look somewhere else, sure, or pretend you're writing notes, but then not really writing notes and email. There's a lot of things you can do because you're not in front of each other, right? So the point is, it's like TV, it's like television, right? Television is entertaining, and even during breaks, they have these entertaining commercials. It's the same concept. You need to keep things engaged. What Jesse did earlier with the poll question, that's great. Try to do that throughout the day, right? And so keep them engaged. And so like what we did,
I was just about to ask you that question. What did you guys do during break time, so to speak?
Yeah, so during break time, we did a couple of things. So the first thing is we actually hired a professional comedian actually, fortunately, it was total coincidence. He was an insurance broker. So we're an insurtech conference.
There's already a punchline there somewhere.
Yeah, it was an insurance broker who hated the insurance industry and left, became a comedian. But insurance people like being made fun of, so it was totally fine. And so we brought him in. He did like 2 15-minute break time show, right? And so it was like semi funny. It was okay. I mean, I'm sorry. This is being recorded, right? It was really funny. No, he was really funny. Some people liked it more than others. Personally, I thought it was pretty funny. But anyway, it was really good. And I think the other point is, even if it wasn't like the humor that they liked, they kind of just liked the idea that we had it. And so that they felt appreciated, right? So I think that's something they could do. Yeah.
Did you get the sense that, you know, virtual conferences, I think, have been happening for at least 5-10 years probably on some scale, but now like everybody, like we have over 100 attendees on this webinar. There's a reason for that. People are needing to do this. It's not really an option anymore. Do you feel so? And people are new to it as well, right? They're learning how to do this and experimenting, and we all are kind of learning together. Did you feel that people had a bit more patience for like experimentation and trying new things in this format? So like the comedian, for example, is maybe a little bit different, but you know, they appreciated and kind of understood that, hey, they're trying to make this work. Like, did you get that sort of sense from people?
Maybe. I think one sort of advantage we probably had is like when we changed to virtual, a lot of people were just concerned whether we'd be able to have this conference at all, right? And so they weren't used to attending virtual conferences. So it was like, to your point, it was a new novel type of stuff. So they were willing to kind of give it a chance, I think. So you're probably right. And I think going forward, I would guess people hopefully will be, and they'll be more creative in providing these like new things that I haven't tried before. Yeah.
Awesome. Cool. So from event design, you said no dead time. Basically, any break should be filled with an insurance broker, comedian, or whatever makes sense for your event or conference. Maybe just the MC again, with some sort of prepared remarks or something, or who knows?
Yeah, I mean, there's so many things you can do. You can do like a yoga session. Maybe you can do a meditation session. We can run commercial videos of our sponsors.
What could be interesting too is like multiple breakout room options of sort of break time, right? So you could have like the yoga meditation room, you could have the insurance broker comedian, you could have, I don't know, like how to solve a Rubik's cube in 15 minutes or whatever, something like that, right? So you could kind of choose your own adventure, which I think, you know, you can do at conferences, but you're limited by, especially in breaks, if it's like 10, 15, 20 minutes and you're in like a huge conference center, and sometimes it takes 10, 15 minutes to walk the salon where that event is actually happening. So I think there's room definitely to get creative there and, you know, pull on the random strengths and skills that your team has to fill that gap with something kind of fun and maybe a little nutty just for, you know, to keep people entertained. Cool. Anything else around event design?
Well, this is sort of like design related, but you know, you want people to join, right? You want people to attend, obviously.
And these are all paid, like your tickets are paid, correct?
Yeah, these are paid. So you want to make sure that they know that we're doing it in a virtual format and how to join and how to network. So we definitely communicated, we could have done even more, but really just continue to send them emails on directions on how to join and how to participate to not only attendees, but also our speakers. Speakers are people too, and they get distracted. And so we over-communicated like how to participate multiple times. So that's definitely something you need to do.
Got it. So communicate. Were you using mostly email, or did you like create a Slack group for the conference and had major announcements and like an announcements channel, or is that something that people should consider? You think?
Yeah, we did. Just a thought. Slack was something we thought about, but not everybody uses Slack, even though like you and I were in tech world, so like we use Slack all the time, but not everybody uses that. So we didn't want to yet ask them to learn another tool just for our conference. But I mean, it depends on your audience, right? We use mostly email. We actually texted people as well, because we do have numbers from the registration. And then for speakers, we call them and set up a meeting.
Awesome. Yeah, I'd love to go deeper if we have time, or if someone wants to ask a question about it during the Q&A section about communicating, just simply communicating. What's the best way, strategies for that thing, issues that you ran into with attendees, with partners, with speakers, with sponsors? I'm sure that's its own challenge. I mean, of course, it's a huge challenge for an in-person conference as well, but for virtual, I think even more so.
So,
speakers and content, I think, is the next piece that you've spoken about before.
Yeah, so speakers, actually, this is a good segue, because there's a lot of communication to speakers that you need to do. And as I mentioned multiple times, speakers are your content, right? That's main part of your product. And so you want to make sure that they know what they're doing in your conference. So first thing is, you know, just try to make sure that they're prepared. And so there are two things you need to do to prepare them. One is just make sure they're prepared to share what, you know, their answers when they're asked a question on the panel, or that they're prepared when they do their presentation. This is what you're supposed to do anyway, also in person, but it's again, very important to continue to do that. We actually set up meetings with every speaker, right? Just for their content prep. Okay, so that's one thing we did. And we started that, you know, 2-3 weeks before the conference. And we continued to do that and made sure everybody was prepared, number one. And then number two,
can I ask a quick question around that? So that's pretty standard, I think, for any conference planning, in person or otherwise. Did those conversations change once you moved to virtual? Like, did you need to go through it again, or you thought, okay, most people attending this probably have, you know, presented online at some point?
Yeah. So content prep, to your point, is something you have to do anyway, but I would just encourage you to do that even more, because one of the things that happens is any kind of mistake that happens virtually, it just gets more magnified. It's just weird. I can't really put a finger on why that's the case, but maybe it's just because you're in front of a screen and you notice like something on your face. Yeah.
There's just fewer distractions, I think. Like, you don't have whatever 1,000 people next to you in a room to look at, or someone's like scooting by you to sit in a chair, or what, like all those random distractions that are going on that could draw your attention elsewhere. That just doesn't exist. So
or maybe they're right in front of you as opposed to a stage like far behind. And so things get magnified. So you just want to make sure they're really prepared. So that's number one. But number two is we actually make sure that they're set up properly technology wise, and they know how to actually participate in a virtual setting. So we actually had separate meetings aside from the content prep, one-on-one meetings. Well, not one-on-one. We had like many sessions that they could sign up for. And then we went through basically like 5 or 10 things that, you know, they should do before they join. And so we created a guide, virtual guide. It's actually I don't know, Jesse, you talked about this, but I created a guide. We created a guide for this, about how to convert into a virtual conference. And in it, there's a link that we that has a document that we share with the speakers.
Let me just pause you one sec just to mention this again to the audience. I think this was mentioned in the event description. We may have mentioned it at the beginning, but Tony wrote an article on his website, InsurTech. It's InsurTechNY.com, right? And we'll send it out afterwards. But it's basically a blog post detailing all of his experience and a lot of the points that we're talking about here that are a little bit more fleshed out and written down. So it sounds like there's more like sort of a checklist for speakers that you should take advantage of if it's out there. So we'll send that in a follow-up email after the webinar is over to everybody. So I just wanted to make sure people were aware that existed.
Great. Yeah, I wasn't the only author. I co-wrote this with my partner, David Gritz. But yeah, this is definitely there. So create a guide, but then we also had a meeting with all of them because you can't rely, depend on everyone to read that guide again because, you know, we're distracted again. So you just want to make sure that they have at least gone through it verbally at least once, and then the guide is a second resource. So we had a meeting with everyone, including the judges, and going through, okay, this is the conference, this is a tool, you have to download this or don't download it. These are the steps that you need to do to join. You need to join 30 minutes before, every single detail. If audio doesn't work, this is the backup audio, right? Do you have Ethernet cable? You don't have it. Does the Wi-Fi work? Going through all the different steps that you need to take. And this is important because all of those things are failure points. So that's totally one thing
sorry to interrupt real quick, but just an anecdote quickly. So you know what that makes me think of, where a similar situation completely failed was, you remember the Iowa caucus, which happened earlier this year, where they were trying to roll out some new app to all the different caucus leaders or whatever, and they weren't effectively trained or really like gone through anything at all. And many of them didn't use it. They were using the phones. The phones didn't have enough people staffed to receive the calls, and it just became a complete mess.
Yeah.
My big takeaway from that, especially having worked in positions in tech where that's basically been my job, is like a customer adoption of your product. You need to go through every point with people. Don't assume that they just know how to use the technologies, whether they're in the tech world, you know, they're a software engineer, whatever. You can't assume. I think that's really, really key and a really good point.
Absolutely. Yeah. I mean, 100%. Yeah. So you just make sure that you go through in the meeting we had, we called it a tech test meeting. We had them go through the exact process that they needed to go through in the actual event, test their audio, test their video, everything, right? And so I thought that was probably very helpful in making sure we had no speaker, no shows, like everybody was on time, all 80 of them, which was really good for us. And then just in terms of speakers, even after you share the guide and the tech test meeting and give them additional communication through emails, you may still have some speakers who will not join. It happens, okay? So when that happens, you want to make sure you're able to call them. So have phone numbers of every speaker. This is very, very important. It came in handy with us as well. So if they don't join on time, call them so that they join. So be aggressive in getting all their phone numbers, which we did.
And did you have a situation, it sounds like you didn't, but maybe you did, a situation where a speaker did not show up and you tried calling them and you weren't able to get in touch, so that session, that talk was essentially just
So because we did all these things prep and because we had our phone number, we were able to call them and make sure they joined at least a few minutes before, so we didn't have any no-shows. We started everything ended on time and all the speakers were there.
I was going to ask you, what would you do in that situation? Just try to pull the insurance broker comedian back on stage to tell a few quick, you know, spur of the moment jokes. That's obviously a challenging situation.
No, but that's something you need to think about that. And that's really great that Jesse, you're thinking about that, because any of these things can happen, right? So you need to anticipate it, which is why you need to have backups for basically almost everything.
Right. So
Yeah.
All right, go ahead.
Yeah, so for example, we had a backup for, so wait, just thinking about the content, different sessions we have. We had a panel discussion, which requires moderator and 3 to 4 speakers, okay? So our backup for moderator was, we had a backup moderator, which was my partner, because he does a good job moderating. So if the moderator doesn't show up, then he'll moderate. So we had a backup moderator. And then in terms of speakers, we had 3 or 4 speakers. So if one or two doesn't show up, we'll just do it with the 2 speakers, right? And so right. We didn't have to do that, but that was a backup. In terms of like presentations, if they didn't show up, then we probably just have to run a break, additional break, maybe bring in more comedian. But you know, there are other content we could just run, and we'll have a break. And then for startup pitches, if they didn't show up, then we'll just do it without them. We have 10, right. 20 pitches, so if miss one or two, it's not going to be the end of the world.
Yeah. Right. Awesome. Cool. So I think the last piece I want to make sure we leave at least 10 minutes for Q&A. Is emergency preparedness, right? And I think you may have touched on that a little bit with like how to fill in certain situations if the speaker doesn't show up or whatever. Can you speak to that a little bit and how you approach that?
Yeah, so basically it's backup is the key term here. So we just have backups or anything. I mentioned backups for basic speakers, but try that backups for technology. And backups, or if something's fail, like what should you do? For example, our backup for Zoom was GoToWebinar. It was this tool. We honestly, if Zoom failed, it would have been a disaster because we didn't plan on how to use GoToWebinar. We didn't actually, you know, practice too much as GoToWebinar, but at least we thought of it. If you have more time, we definitely would have practiced more GoToWebinar, but try to have a backup tool for your technology. You definitely should have a backup for when technology fails for a particular person. So with the Zoom, we have a feature where they can talk through the computer audio, but right, which we prefer because it's just more seamless that way. But as a backup, because internet speed is something you can't like guarantee, as a backup, we show people how to call in using the phone. And so fortunately for us, most speakers on the day of the event were able to speak freely through the computer audio. Most of them didn't have internet issues, but there were like 2 people who did have internet issues, and one person ended up, their internet just kind of dropped. It didn't work, right? But we told them how to actually call in. So he called in and we were able to continue running it. And so definitely have a backup for all these situations. A key thing is with virtual conference, there's a lot of failure points. In person, it's really like you're there and then, you know, that's it. There's only really one failure point, right? One equipment. With virtual conference, every person has their own equipment. Every one of them is a failure point.
Right. That's a scary thing to say out loud. Everyone is a failure point.
Everyone's a failure point. So, You need to have a backup for, you know, as many of those failure points as possible.
Right. Cool. Any final points or should we go straight to questions? I think we have about 10-ish minutes left.
Yeah, I think we can probably go into questions. Yeah.
Awesome. Sarah, do you want to take over the question part?
Yes, absolutely. So thank you guys so much for all this fantastic content you've gotten. In addition to a lot of questions, just a lot of comments saying how useful and applicable this is. So you're really striking a chord with folks, which is great. There's a couple questions that seem to be pretty speedy to answer and then some that are more in depth. So I'm just gonna throw the quick ones to you first and kind of try and get through those, and then we'll dive into the longer ones. So just some quick ones to start with. Tony, how many members were part of your team to facilitate the 7-day switch?
We had, including all the volunteers, probably about, I want to say about 8 or 9 people.
And any advice for folks who are working with smaller teams than that?
Get more volunteers. So one thing with conferences, right, it's really a great avenue for people to make great connections with, and there's a lot of benefits as a volunteer. So I actually, before we started this conference, I volunteered for another conference. because it will allow me to be sort of part of a central kind of group of the organizers, right? So it allowed me to make better connections with people. So you can definitely attract a lot of great number of volunteers. So I would definitely encourage you to get more people. You do need more people. You try, don't try to
potentially. Sorry.
But, no, go ahead.
No, I was going to say even potentially reach out to like speakers and people. You know is that a realistic avenue to go down? You think?
No, I mean you don't want speakers to volunteer for you. You just want like other people. For example, like student organizations, maybe like people from Georgetown. If you're a Georgetown alum and you're running an event, maybe you can reach out to your Georgetown people and ask, hey, anyone want to help out? You know, in our website, we actually, we might not have this, but, we run newsletters periodically, and we ask for people, hey, if you want to help us, you know, let us know. And we got a few people, volunteering. Yeah.
Great. Thank you. Another question. How long did it take you to decide on the platform you ultimately ended up using?
So for Zoom, it didn't take too long. We did spend probably like 2 days just researching a little bit. I was somewhat biased in using Zoom because I was so familiar with it, but we had a member of our staff research BlueJeans, GoToWebinar, and the others, and just kind of based on our familiarity and then some of the drawbacks the other tools had versus Zoom, we decided to go with Zoom. But you know, they all work, just they're slightly different. There's pros and cons. A couple of days. In terms of the networking app, we didn't, we looked at other tools, but this was when we were looking for an in-person networking app. We just kind of lucked out that they had a virtual option, you know, hopefully that answers your question.
Yeah, that's great. And to follow up on that, what are some of the shortcomings you found when using Zoom?
Shortcomings. So one thing that I don't know, and I don't know if other tools have this, but one additional feature that I wish it had is like a waiting room. So when speakers join, they could potentially be in a waiting room where they're just talking things privately, and then we can move them to the stage, right? They don't have that feature in Zoom. So I wish they had that. That's really it. I mean, I don't really have too many complaints. Sometimes like, you know, there's little glitches here and there, like when I try to move people, like it doesn't move. Those are a couple of things that pop in my head. I mean, overall, I'm pretty happy with Zoom. There's obviously privacy issues that people have. I mean, that's not something that I was thinking about, but you know, I hear that it's easily hackable and stuff like that. So I don't know. I think other tools might be more secure.
And then continuing on the thread of talking about Zoom, how do you deal with quote Zoom fatigue? So people getting distracted and starting doing other things like navigating away. Talk about that a little bit.
Yeah. So we sort of talked about this earlier, but it's really like keep them engaged. Right, keep it entertaining, do polls, questions, don't have dead silent breaks, try to provide some kind of content, but be cognizant of the fact that, you know, they will likely, if you're doing all day conference, they're not going to be there, you know, attending it all day. They will do other stuff. What that means is you need to keep communicating what's going to happen in the next hour, right? What's the agenda? Just kind of keep repeating that. It is what it is. I mean, you just have to know that that's going to happen. We basically had, just for your info, we had 500 people register, and then most of them actually joined our Zoom conference. You can actually track who joined, a unique number of visitors. I think we have about 450 unique visitors. And then similar amount doing networking. And I would guess most of them overlap, but then some of them just did one or the other. So that ends up being 500. At a given moment, we had probably 250 people actually attending a particular session. So people are coming in and out throughout the day.
Yeah, that's great. Another question still kind of on the Zoom thread and in general for these platforms, what's your opinion on using video or not? What's the value add of showing the person while weighing the risk of lagging the content?
What's the last sentence? Risk of what?
The value add of showing the person versus the risk of possibly lagging the content or having bandwidth issues.
Oh, I see. This is why you need to test ahead of time whether speaker would have these lagging internet connection issues. And if so, then you should have the person turn their video off. But video, I think, is very important. I think there's definitely multiple scientific studies that have been done about communication. And so you can communicate through text or email, but then if you start adding voice tones, it increases the communication ability a little more. And then you start adding facial structure and how you move your face, it just makes the communication a lot more effective. And if you do it in person, that's another level. So even if it seems like you and I and Jesse were having a good conversation, I bet you if you did it in person, it will be better. Because we can smell each other, see things in 3D. There's just more that you will get out of being in person. And so you just want to be close to in person as possible. And so video is definitely more helpful in conveying a message. And so I would definitely highly encourage the speakers to have a video on. But just having said that, most of the people that were on our event really didn't have internet issues except for that one person who, you know, disconnected and just called back then, and obviously that person didn't have video, and that was okay.
Great, thank you. Another question on Zoom and also related to branding. Did you embed the Zoom stream into another platform, like a branded site where you could put your branding and colors and everything? And then also just questions generally around how to keep something a branded feel when you do have to move it virtually.
So when we were planning on doing the in-person event, we were going to live stream it on YouTube. When we switched to the virtual conference, we decided not to live stream. And the reason is attendees were purchasing tickets to join the virtual conference. It didn't seem fair that we'll give it away for free on a live stream to people who didn't purchase a ticket. So that was the decision we made. So people who attended our conference were only able to attend using the Zoom tool. Having said that, for our next conference or next event that we're going to be doing, so we do events throughout the year. Just this was a big one, but we do smaller events throughout the year. And the next event, what we are hoping to do is live stream Zoom into the Grip app and have Grip app be the only source of tool, only tool that I have to use. So there's an integration mechanism that allows you to do that. So you could do something like that.
That's great. And I'm glad you mentioned Grip because we've gotten a couple questions about it as well. Can you talk just some more about how and why you went about choosing it, and then any pros and cons for using it versus, I don't know if there are comparable platforms out there, but pros and cons you saw from using it?
Yeah, so there's definitely other tools. So there's tools that cost a lot of money. So they're like conferences that, you know, have thousands and thousands of people and they're tools that caters to them. And they probably have better features than Grip, but they're also very expensive. And I think they're one of them, I forgot the name, but they require like 100 license as a minimum purchase. So we only needed like one, right? So we didn't need that. So just among this kind of these newer startups type of networking app companies that are out there catered to smaller conferences, there's Grip, there's Brella, which is also popular. And then we're also looking at Tuple Hopin. We like Brella and Grip, but those are the two tools that we actually liked and have used in the past. But we decided to go with Grip based on some of the kind of the features they had, a little more powerful feature in terms of networking and matching and things like that, and asking questions on who you want to meet, and they do a good job matching. So that's why we went with Grip. But I do hear the Brella is also good. I've used Brella as a attendee and it worked pretty well. So you kind of have to compare those two, look at the cost and see if it has the features that you need.
That's great. And can you give us too just ballpark cost of GRIP for those who are interested? It sounds like it's a relatively low cost option, but just ballpark wise.
So I would encourage you to actually connect with those two vendors separately. I mean, it's not going to be, and it really depends on the number of attendees as well. So if you're running a, you know, 1,000-person conference, it's going to be a different cost if you're running a 100-person conference. They do cater towards, you know, conferences that go above like 200, 300, 400 people. And so it's something you might need to kind of talk to them about and negotiate. If you reach out to me, happy to make a connection to the GRIP folks. The founder and the business development person, they are really well, so happy to make the connection.
That's great, thank you. I know we're right at 1 o'clock now. Jesse and Tony, are y'all okay to stick around for another few minutes to continue with Q&A? Great.
Sure, for me, it's okay.
Awesome, thank you. And for those of you who have to hop off, we are recording this session, so if you need to duck out now, that's fine. You'll get a link to the recording that'll have all the future questions and answers. For those of you who can stick around, please continue to do so. We're glad to have you here. Tony and Jesse, I want to jump into some questions sort of around the mechanics of the event itself and away from the technology. So to start off, how does a timekeeper communicate with those who are, quote, on stage in a virtual setting?
Yes, that's a great question. So we came up with probably like 5 or 6 different ways to communicate that, including like what are some audio. We're thinking about texting them. We're thinking about like having a video or like some sign on here that says, hey, you have 1 minute, all kind of stuff. And what we ended up doing is just telling them through audio, 1 minute, 30 seconds, time's up. That was the simplest, most effective way. And it feels like it could be a little intrusive to the audience, but it's not.
So all the attendees could hear that audio, yeah, as well, just to verify, right? Yeah.
Yeah, that's totally fine. And people are okay with it.
Yeah, I was gonna say, wow, so you had them actually interject and interrupt, and that worked fine, it sounds like.
No, that's fine. It's just like a quick, less than a second, 1 minute, you know, and audience members are probably not even paying attention to that. It's just the moderator or speaker who needs to listen to that.
Yeah. Awesome. Another question in regards to staffing an event, you mentioned having a slide person, which obviously that's a key part of an event where you have a speaker. Do you think when you translate that event to virtual, is it better for the speaker to control their own slides and so share their screen and run their own slides, or is it better to have one person running slides for everyone? Talk a bit about that.
Yeah, so we went with the latter, and the reason for this is there's a lot of things that could go wrong if you give control to the other person. So for example, you know, if they start sharing their screen, you don't even know what's gonna be on their desktop. You know, it could be, you know, material that's not suitable for the audience, right? Or maybe as they're sharing their tool, their PowerPoint, it doesn't work, right? So we didn't want to give that control away. We wanted to have us control all the content. And so, for example, with the startup pitches, there are 20 decks, right? So, and then there are 2 sessions, sort of 10 decks for one and then 10 decks for the other. So for each of those PowerPoint decks, we ask people to send it to us in PowerPoint, not Keynote or PDF, but in PowerPoint, consolidated one, and then I controlled it. Now, I controlled it as in I share my desktop, but with Zoom, there's a feature that allows the other person to control. So there's a way that they could request control and then start controlling my desktop. That we knew could fail. So our backup for that failing was audio again. So they'll tell me next slide, and I'll move it. Hopefully that helps.
Awesome, thank you. Another question, how do you balance content running throughout the event so that there's no dead space, but people still feel that they can take a break organically without missing too much?
I'm sorry, can you repeat that? That space,
Yeah, how do you structure the content of the virtual event so that there's not necessarily dead space built in, but so that people feel like they can step away or take a break when they need to and not miss too much?
That's an interesting point. We had breaks. Don't get me wrong, we had breaks. It's just we filled it with different things. And so it was optional. And even the breaks that we had, the comedians, there were some moments where we didn't actually have a session. And so what we did during those breaks is we had like 20, 30 slides that were just kind of rolling every 30 seconds. And each slide would have like a logo of a sponsor, of an agenda, you know, have some comic strips. So we'll continuously want something, and they're always seeing something through those breaks, but they will know that it's a break, and it will have a heading on top that says, hey, we're on a break, come back at a particular point. So they can obviously take a break then.
Great. And then if you have multiple breakout sessions going on at the same time, which I know is something that happens through Zoom, can you just talk us through briefly how the logistics work out for that, and how do you implement that and tell people what breakout sessions they're going to and everything?
So for our conference, we didn't use breakout room feature. It was single track, and so we didn't have to use the breakout room feature. But I've done that in my other smaller events where it was more like a workshop setting. And in those cases, you know, you just have to kind of communicate, hey, we're going to a breakout room, you know, go in, and then, you know, we'll end the breakout room at a particular time, and you come back out. That's happy to kind of share that more in detail separately if you want to reach out, because I've used that feature a lot for speed networking and things of this nature. We didn't do that in this conference.
Great. Another sort of in detail question just about the nature of in-person events. Can you share if you refunded part of the cost or how you address that, since the virtual programming didn't provide some of the same things like in-person events do, like meals and things like that?
Sure. So we are cognizant of that. Although, you know, we really try to replicate almost everything that people, the reason why they bought the ticket, we try to replicate. So content was exactly the same, and then we also offer networking, which we heard from some people who use the networking app that they actually thought the networking was better through virtually than in person. And maybe it's just because they're so distracting or just one-on-one on video, but they thought that was better. Having said that, you're right, lunch and things like this, and some people just like in person better than virtual. So what we did is we actually offered each person who bought the ticket that they could invite two people. So basically, they're getting three tickets for price of one. So we gave them this offer. And on top of this, we gave them a 25% credit to next year's conference. So we thought this was, you know, a good, fair, hopefully more than fair offer, where they don't have to think and be like, oh, that's a no-brainer. So most people took this route, and so we really didn't have to give refunds after we made that decision. Yeah,
that's great. Wonderful. Another question just about breaks. I think people are really intrigued with how to build those in. Examples of how to fill the space during those, like what you might have up on the screen, or, you know, other people you could interject in there, just ideas around that.
I'm sorry, can you repeat that? Sorry.
Just examples on how to fill the space during breaks during the event, what you have up on the screen, or, you know, people to bring in and chat, things like that.
Some ideas. I think we talked about this a bit earlier, but the couple ideas that we implemented. One is have slides that are continuously rolling. A second is we brought in like a entertainer, and in our case it was a professional comedian. We actually had a third thing which I didn't talk about, which is we actually brought in a person from GRIP who showed how to use GRIP to network. So we did that as well. And so, but you know, you can be as creative as you want to be. As I mentioned, you can bring a yoga teacher, you can do stretching exercise. We might actually do that our next event is like do stretching exercises. There's just so many things we can do. It's just, you know, if you're a creative person or you like doing fun things, this is a really good opportunity, actually.
Yeah, those are all really good ideas. The last section of questions, and I know we've still got, you know, plenty of folks asking questions, which is great, but I do want to be mindful of everyone's time and encourage you all to follow up with Tony and Jesse after we wrap today. I'll share their contact information, so please reach out. I know they'd be more than happy to hear from you. So the last section of questions I want to ask is just around analytics. Can you share the tools you use to evaluate how engaged people were, how many people attended, things like that? What analytical tools did you use to evaluate the success of your event?
So we didn't use a separate tool. Zoom, along with GRIP, actually has those analytical tools built in. And so Zoom, for example, you can tell who's attended at what particular time, for how long. And so that's really all you need, I think, for us. And then this GRIP has similar feature. And so GRIP actually has additional analytics, which tells you the number of meetings they had, who they met, things like that. So I think both tools have enough that, you know, we didn't need to use another analytics tool. Is that it? Oh, I think.
Sarah, if you're speaking, we can't hear you.
Yeah, I think she dropped out because I don't see her on the panel.
Uh-oh. Okay. Cool. Well, if that's the case, we'll just take over here quickly. Sarah, if you're back in here, let us know. But just want to thank everybody for coming today. If you have additional questions, I imagine that they will be safe here, I hope. I don't really know, frankly, but feel free to reach out to me. Feel free to reach out. You probably want to reach out to Tony, let's be real. He's the real star of the show here. And I just want to thank Tony for agreeing to come on and share his experience with us. So thank you everybody for coming. And one final thing, if you enjoyed this content, if you want to come to Hoya Tech events in New York, feel free to join the Georgetown Tech Alliance of New York group. We have a LinkedIn group as well as an email list that will be sent out in email following the webinar, along with I think similar stuff for Tony with Insurtech NY, along with his article that he wrote with his team. So we appreciate you all coming and hope to see you at the next webinar whenever that is.
Thanks for having me, Jesse, and Georgetown team. Talk to you guys later.
You're now officially an honorary Hoya, Tony.
Yes. Thank you.
All right, cool.
Bye-bye.
Thank you, everybody. Bye.